now? At now or most ready? Yeah, welcome to the Vegetable Drink. My name is Nina Gajewski, and I'm a student in nutrition and health from the University of Absalon. And we graduated in January 2018, and I work together with Dominic, which is with me here today. And we have our specialty study subject in management food and service. And the bachelor assignment is planned to develop so it can be used as research consultants after this. And like most other people, I would like to live healthy on a daily basis. But in a busy everyday life, it can be difficult to reach that. So in the spring 2016, I was beginning to work at home. And all this schoolwork used to be that it didn't have a lot anymore. So then I thought if I can't buy the stuff, I have to make it myself. And I was fortunate enough to say out loud to my study group, and here I am now 1.5 years later, and I've been able to work with it dedicated for 1.5 years now. And according to the Danish Health Authority, we should consume 600 grams of fruit and vegetable every day, but not many of us actually do. So the plan was to develop a healthy, nutritious alternative snack. And in my traineeship at the organization 4-H, I developed carry through activities for kids, like fuel activity, where they could choose recipes from photos. Then they got handed out a basket and some gloves, and then they could just go ahead and make their own juice. And that was a great opportunity for me to find out if the kids in college would actually like this project, and a lot of employees to work on, to go on with our project. And instead of calling it a juice, we call it a vegetable drink. So we won't associate it with the sweet fruit juices. And it's planned that they will be available in two sizes, 160 and 250 milliliters, and in stock pack and plastic bottles. And we worked out 4 or 6 varieties, but we'll have to see how that comes out. We want to challenge the market with a product which is spot on the future food trends, like sustainability, convenience, organics, and undisclosed space. We had a lot of forcing challenges, and one of them was that it should be on local organic and excess produce, which led to a cooperation with Caterbox, which is a caterer of fruit and vegetables, and in order to try to minimize their food waste, which will try to take the produce out and put them in our production, so we can minimize the food waste. The challenge is that if you only take a cold pressed juice, it would only be able to have a shelf life in 5 days, which is not enough at all to get it from the production out in the stores. So I found out there's a high pressure processing machine, a technology called HPP, which on several products can increase the shelf life up to 60 days. And that's the machine here. You put in the processed products in here, and then they come in this machine, and they'll be pressed with 5,000 to 6,000 bars in a circle of 3 to 5 minutes. And the enzyme activity would go down, so we can increase the shelf life. And I would like to show you a short movie.
Starts out the same, but it's the journey from farm to fridge that makes it different. Most juices are made, well, the regular way, using fast spinning blades to chop up and separate the juice, and heat pasteurization, sometimes at up to 120 degrees, stripping vital nutrients. Often, locally made juices are simply blended together from other juice ingredients made somewhere overseas. So who knows where they're really from? At Impress Juices, our approach is different. Our juice is cold pressed from fresh produce and never heat treated. We use 100% Aussie grown fruits and vegetables sourced direct from the farm, which we gently squeeze through a linen cloth in a hydraulic press, slowly extracting nature's goodness, bursting in flavor and nutrients. We cold fill into our handy little bottles that are high pressure tested to deactivate harmful bacteria. It's just like dropping them to the deepest part of the ocean. No heat, no half-truths. Our juice stays chilled from farm to fridge. Pretty impressive, huh? Experience the difference of Impress Juices and get more truth in your juice.
Yeah, and it then turned out when I found out about the EPP that there doesn't exist a machine in Denmark. They got two or three in Sweden, three or four in Germany. It's a process which is
then you have at the university, but the University of Copenhagen, you do have one.
Yeah, it's a test machine.
It's not, yeah, it's not for the production.
Yeah, I know. But the production, it's at big scales, it's just not yet. So therefore, I had to get in touch with a German producer, and I also visited them because they had both the capacity to produce the juice and into the product. So instead of having a local Danish product, it would be a local German product, and I'll just have to live with that until I maybe be able to get a machine to Denmark. But I didn't really give up the dream about having this Danish product, so we got in touch with a Danish producer, and they heard about the HPP, but they doesn't have a really evidence-based knowledge to make a decision whether to buy a machine or not. So now we are actually making a part of our batch of projects where we are going to investigate the HPP methods, so they might be interested to buy a machine actually. And another chance is that if you make a juice, I don't know if you ever saw it in the market, you'll always have the dietary fiber cell at the bottom, and it will be light at the top, and it doesn't really look good at in the stores at the shelves. So in order to try to make it keep this bright beautiful colors in red or orange or green or whatever, we have a test with an emulsifier, which could actually keep all this product together, and that's something we're working on as well, and having a lot of business in trying to develop this, this specific product. And it's a product who would not only work as an emulsifier, but it would also have the characteristics so that they could increase the health in by the intake of this product. So it would be a very different product to the other products in the market. We have an ongoing work to do still, and during the whole education we tried to have these intersectoral collaborations with other education institutes or businesses, and we got one with the CBC Business School in Slagelse, and we actually work as a case for their students in marketing and economy. So they are trying to make an analyze about this product in 7 groups and how to see how they can put this product on the market. And we have, they already have found another purchaser for us, so I believe our next business meeting will be with them. We have to work out the review report, and we have passed that our bachelor assignment. And during all this process, we thought about how could we make this better in the future. And for us, it has been a very good to have a sponsor and a mentor on the side. It has given us the opportunities to discuss the ideas and talk about how we could go on from now. And I believe I heard him said that I'm bringing in the balloons and he's trying to take them out of them again so we could all make the project fit together. And in the beginning I thought, oh, I was getting a lot of information from him. But after a while, I found out that we actually bring in many things to their company as well, because we get new ideas as students, we have the newest knowledge, and a lot of energy. So that was nice to get to know that as well. But to make us a bit more for him, I made a report about their customer's view on the company's CSR profile. So again, I learned to use my skills as well. We talked a lot about the professional integrated relationships. We had basic catering on our side, and this business plan, having something that you can see that, oh, this is actually going to be a real product we can get on the market, and I have some good concepts here, is essential. We had the problems that a lot of the things we tried to work on, it always takes time to build up the relationships and find the right people. So if these relationships would be there at the beginning of the study, I think that future products would be able to move a lot faster and much further than we are now. And we specifically worked on the cooperation to get a logo for this nice product. But even though we worked with it for over a year now, we didn't succeed in getting a partner there. So that would be very nice for the future. Then there's also the money issue, because everything costs, and we've been happy and lucky to have Hintergrund as our sponsor. So all the tests we did didn't cost us anything, so we got very far on the side already. And our point and idea is that if there would be some kind of funding where products could apply for money in specific it could get, I was able to buy my ticket to go on a plane and go to Germany and go to food trends conferences and a lot of other things, but that's not a luxury that common student has. Networking is another important part of this. You have to spread the word about the project. In the beginning, you have to keep it in a little small close, but as the project moves on, it's crucial that it would be out in the open to go to students, teachers, family, Facebook, whatever, and search for information about things that would be relevant for the project. A lot of our students ask me, how did you find all this stuff that you're going to all the time? Well, it's just like getting out on the internet and search for it. And I think that if you work in doing it, good branding these things and learn more about it, would be able to get the sense from it as well. The confidential agreement about a project is very important. For us, during the whole process, we work with it in a lot of time now, at a time where many of our students didn't even know what they would use their education for afterwards. So we often figured out that they couldn't see why it was important for us to keep it in this closed circle. But it's important that everybody understands how important and all these small projects are. We have actually a co-student right now who's working on developing a machine which could measure the impact on modified food for people with swallowing problems. So it's very important that parts like this doesn't get open to others just to give an idea. And another thanks would be to our teachers. I didn't know there would be so many of them here today as I wrote it. But our engaged teachers has been a very big role in during the last 1.5 years, because they always took me serious and tried to figure out how we could get this project further. And that leads to that I'm actually standing here today. And it's very important that the teachers as well know what the students are working with and that's again, this intersectoral work should have a bigger part in the future. And like Bastian also talked about, that the education has a lot of pressure, so of course there has to be some money and some time for it as well. Yeah. That was what I had. So I'm open for questions, and English, German, or Danish, it's up to you.
Thank you very much. So we will have a few questions and then we gradually turn it into a panel debate with more actors.
I wonder very much, what does it taste like? I mean, fresh vegetable juice tastes really nice. Heat treated tastes pretty awful. And probiotically treated taste has a very specific taste. But does, yeah, what does it taste like? Because I think that's very important for the
seeds. You mean after the HP treatment?
Yeah, exactly.
It actually keeps the same
Really?
Yeah, same quality.
Wow.
And shelf life says if you, up to 60 days, it will still keep the color. Afterwards, it will begin to fade, but it will still have the taste and the sensory quality. And you can actually drink it up to 3 months. So it still has the freshness.
And do you know for sure that the nutritions are still sort of left in the product?
Yeah, we're still working on it, but the articles and the information feed out the users of the machines would say, some say 3% and some say 10 to 15, but we're working it out and trying to fit together, because it also depends on what's in the products. But
And that machine, since there's not so very many of them, is that hugely expensive.
Yeah, it's
so that really, when it comes to that, you're not, the price is going to be very high on them all.
The machine, the investment in it would be about 1.1 million euros. So it's a very expensive machine. But we just came from another meeting this Friday with a producer of the HP machines, and he said that if there would be a machine on the Danish market, you would have the first 10 customers who would like to get their products HPP treated. And it also makes that there would be another, a big market for developing new products, which we couldn't do today. So it brings a lot of innovative with this as well.
Thank you. Next question.
I have a question about the pulp matter, where you explained that all the carrot, all the vegetables need pulp in the bottom.
Yeah.
Is so your evaluation of how well that is perceived by the customers, is that your evaluation? Because I know that, for instance, orange juices have pulp, but that's almost considered un, like that's something you want, because then you know that it's freshly squeezed.
Yeah.
Why don't you want?
I want it, but I just don't want it to be settled at the bottom. So that you have this dark green, for example, in the bottom, and then you have this light green fluid in the top of it. It doesn't look very good at the shelves.
So my question is, have you tested this on people? Are they okay with just shaking it?
Not really now, but we're looking at the design of the logos and the design of the bottles, and we would like to have that showing on the shelf. It is crucial that you have this color. So.
Okay, because I think before putting emulsifiers,
yeah, but it's still a natural product, so it's not that we are going to make something and put something in it. It will still be a fresh, real ingredients. So so it's not a chemical reaction.
So we have a lot of questions. We can continue that, but I also like in the meantime also to ask the panel up here, it's Bastian, and also the same person that were in the first panel, so we still wanted, you know, pump you on some information. So please take your seats while we continue the question.
What is about the value chain and the machine? Yeah, do you see here somebody as the machine owner? Or could it be the catered one, or could it be an intermediate?
There are many possibilities right now. We talked about the Danish producer, and they're actually interested in buying this machine if they could have the good feeling about that what the treatment is doing to the buffers. And that's what we are trying to figure out now, really. And if not, I can see it as well, like I could buy the machine for my own and then just do the treatment for everybody.
So then you would be featuring that and the juice to
and so so that's the conditions changes all the time, and I just have to see what it is, but I see a lot of options.
So some hands over here?
I know the high pressure is really good at prolonging the shelf life, but what about the color? What about the browning? Does it do any good for the browning? Because that must be an issue.
Yeah, it still keeps the colors after 60 days, and afterwards it will begin to fade.
Okay, so it inactivates the enzyme.
Yeah, but you can still consume the product, but the color will change.
So the color does change.
Yeah, after 6 days.
After 6 days.
Yeah.
So you can only really stabilize the color for 6 days.
Yeah,
60 days.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah.
And afterwards, then still consume it with the colors.
Yeah. Okay.
So,
yeah,
that should
be fine.
Yeah. You can
How much of the pulp are you pressing through the filters? I think. How much of the fiber is in the product?
We haven't made measures on it yet at this point, because we still only got the test in on kitchen thing. We didn't have it through a commercial machine yet. So.
Excellent. So please take your seat in the panel. It seems like you. We will continue. Yes, please. We are going to continue with your cases and your presentation.